economic well-being also impact educational opportunities. Now, the goal of Dr. King and leaders today is to make sure that all of our students could access great universities like here at Howard. But what we know is that African American and Latino children are significantly more likely to live in poor neighborhoods than non-Hispanic whites. And we know that higher poverty rates among minority children and lower academic attainment of their parents both have a direct impact on those children's school achievements. But we also know an important fact. We know that all children can learn. And we know that we can do a lot to help them learn. And that's why the administration is also turning a spotlight on education, from infant and toddler years through college and graduate school, like here at Howard. Now, at HHS, we're working closely with the Department of Education to raise the quality and increase the access to early education programs. Because what we know is this: children who have access to high-quality preschools go to school with the same emotional and developmental skills as their peers, and they have all the tools by age five that they need to succeed. That's a big step forward. Kids who often don't show up in kindergarten ready to learn are so far behind, by the time they're in the third grade, they never catch up. So the investment at the earliest stages of that life are so important. So President Obama's asked Education Secretary Arne Duncan and me to work together to ensure that all of our children are in safe learning environments in their preschool years. Safe learning environments. We need to make sure that they are ready for school so they can take advantage of quality K-12 education and have an opportunity to attend college. Now, we're not going to achieve Dr. King's dream overnight, but we are making progress in the right direction. And I want to just share with you one example right here at our doors in Washington, D.C., of some of the new partnerships that we're trying to develop at HHS. Last summer, again at the President's direction, we launched our first ever comprehensive national HIV/AIDS strategy, which will focus resources on communities across the country that have been hardest hit by this disease. In the past, there's been a lot of focus on this disease and a lot of focus internationally, but not so much a national strategy for what we're doing in our own communities. So our new national strategy provides a roadmap to reduce new infections, to increase access to care, and improve health outcomes for those living with HIV and AIDS. It's a national strategy, but it depends on local action. So we need to build strong partnerships with the help of businesses, governments, with people living with HIV, and so many others. The national strategy highlights a critical role for faith leaders to reach out to communities in support of HIV prevention, to encourage testing, and certainly to encourage treatment efforts. Now, DC can become a national model for this kind of collaboration. Unfortunately, right here in the District of Columbia, we have one of the highest HIV/AIDS rates in the country. At least 3% of DC's adults and adolescents are living with HIV, and we think that's an undercount because, frankly, too many people have not yet been tested. Now, communities of color nationwide are particularly vulnerable to HIV and AIDS, but the situation in DC is particularly alarming. African Americans represent more than 3/4 of DC's HIV/AIDS cases. So a year ago, our scientists at the National Institute of Health launched a DC partnership for HIV/AIDS progress, $27 million research-focused initiative designed to address the district's HIV/AIDS epidemic. The new partnership called on scientists and doctors from Howard, from George Washington University, and a whole host of institutions across the district, studying the circumstances and behaviors that place African Americans in our city at high risk for HIV infection. We've opened brand new clinics to treat illnesses that have a special impact on HIV patients, like hepatitis. We're studying the so-called test and treat approach to reducing the spread of HIV, expanding testing efforts, and moving people who test for HIV immediately into care and treatment, since we know that people who know their HIV status and who are being treated are much less likely to spread the virus to others. But in order for programs like these to have the greatest impact, they need to reach deep into our communities. So I'm here today to ask for help. Help in putting the brakes on the spread of HIV here in Washington, D.C. As students and faith leaders, as academics and activists, as members of the Howard community and district residents, you can help play a vital role. People in this community trust you. They respect you, they look up to you, and they will follow where you lead. So please help us reach out. We need your help in sending messages throughout the community for folks to get tested and know their own status, to help break down the walls of shame and stigma that still perpetuate the HIV epidemic. And we need your help in connecting the positive cases with the treatment and care they need. So your participation and your leadership can make a huge difference. So here we are more than 40 years after Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s death, and we still have a long way to go to achieve his vision. His vision for a country where every member of our community productively contributes and participates in our nation's life and is able to reach his or her own God-given potential. With the historic legislation of the last 2 years, and with the administration that has no tolerance for the status quo on disparities, we are on the right track. And as we move forward, we're also mindful of another one of Dr. King's famous lines, that change doesn't roll on the wheels of inevitability, but it comes through continuous struggle. Now, Dr. King pointed the way. The new legislation we have has helped take down some of the barriers and obstacles. And now it falls to us to keep moving forward, to build a society where everyone has a chance to live a happy and productive and prosperous life. Thank you for what you do each and every day, and I look forward to our partnership for a healthier America.
Thank you, Secretary Sebelius. And now if you would join me in a litany for healthcare, civil, and human rights. I will read the section designated one, and please join me in reading together all. Let us pray for our nation's ongoing struggle to create equal and accessible healthcare, and for the people of this nation, that we might be emboldened to fight for the civil and human rights of all. For the 45 million people in America, including 8 million children, lacking health insurance, for those with limited insurance coverage, and for those experiencing personal bankruptcies caused by medical bills, we pray. For the ever-increasing health insurance premiums, which have doubled in the last 8 years, rising 3.7 times faster than wages in the past 8 years, and the increasing co-pays and deductibles that continue to threaten access to medical care, we pray. For economic security, job creation, and for direct assistance that helps those in need, the unemployed and underemployed, we pray. That as a nation, we will work to ensure equal opportunities for all students to learn and be college and career ready upon graduation. For the reduction of concentrated poverty and racial isolation in schools, the creation of safe and healthy schools that reduce incidences of bullying, that additional resources be targeted for schools and programs that prioritize vulnerable populations in high-risk communities, and that parents educators, and community members participate in all stages of school improvement, we pray. That all of us may be more sensitive to the numerous injustices that occur each day around us in our homes, schools, places of worship, neighborhoods, states, nation, and in the world, that we might become the change that we want, the beloved community, we pray. O God of love, justice, and mercy, receive the prayers of your people. Enliven us by your Spirit to live into the fullness of your glory. Fill us with the passion to not only pray for justice, but to live as your people, a people of justice, mercy, and humbleness of heart. Amen.
Please join me again in expressing our appreciation to Secretary Sebelius. And now as we prepare to depart, we'd ask that you would join standing with me in a benediction. Hypertension, diabetes, HIV, and more. Broken lives, broken homes, broken education, all around us. There is so much that we seek, O God, so much that we need. Wholeness, wellness, life abundant. This, your salvation, do we seek to be made whole and of one piece, complete within and without. Grant unto us, O God, your presence, and make us treat each other as we would want to be treated ourselves. Ashe.